Good morning, Champion Forest. Would you stand to your feet as we celebrate all that Jesus has done for us and his sacrifice on the cross? Come on, we sing. Do you see what I see? Do you see what I see?
Could not keep him down. Christ is risen. And because he is risen, he calls to us, calls us from darkness and into light, calls us from death and into life. Christ is risen. Christ is risen. And you call my name, and I ran out of that grave. Out of the darkness into your glorious day.
Now those altars in the wilderness. body but Jesus. Who pulled me out of that? Come on, we sing it.
He did, he did.
Who paid for nobody but
Good morning, North Klein. I've got some good news for you this morning. The tomb is empty and the Lord Jesus Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. You may be seated. It is so great to see you this morning. I know we've got some guests here today. We want to give you a special welcome, guests. Thank you for coming to worship with us this morning. We would love for you to take your phones and text the word guest to 77069 or scan the QR code on the seat in front of you. That will help us to get to know you just a little better, and it'll help you to get to know us just a little better. And so we're so grateful you're here. If you want to know what we're about at North Klein, it's loving God and loving people. So guests, we're so glad you're here. We just want to remind you, you matter to God and you matter to us. We're going to ask our ushers to come forward. We're going to worship the Lord through our giving. And guests, by the way, Michelle and I are going to be at the guest tent on your way out. You may have seen it. And we've got a gift we want to give you. And so guests, please stop by. We want to personally shake your hand and give you a small gift and thank you for being here. And guests, as we receive our offering this morning, we're not asking you to give. Your presence here today is your gift to us. So thank you. Let's pray. Father, we're so excited that you're here. Lord, we thank you for our Good Friday service where nearly 70 people got baptized at Champion Forest for the way that you're moving in our midst. Lord, we thank you for all the hundreds of people that were here Saturday night and again this morning and those that are here today. Father, we're so thankful for our guests today. We pray that you help them to have a great experience here at North Klein. And Father, as we worship you through giving, we pray that you take these gifts, that you multiply them. Lord, we realize that all these ministries at North Klein can't exist without the generosity and the kindness of our people. And so, Father, thank you that you're working in our midst. Take these gifts and multiply them to make your name great and to change lives all around us. In your name we pray. Amen.
Sing this together today.
God sent his son. They called him Jesus. He came to love, heal and forgive. He lived and died to buy my pardon. An empty grave is there. Because he lives, I
but it wasn't over till you said it's over. Your word is greater still. The perfect sacrifice, your body broken, as you restore to us what sin had stolen.
Still, Lord, His name is risen. Would you pray with me this morning, Heavenly Father? That's our heart, that's our cry, that's our worship before you today. That you are the name above all names, God, all praise, all glory, all honor. God, it all belongs to you. And God, as we gather in this room today as a church family, God, to encourage one another, to love one another, God, Lord, I pray that we would push one another towards you. God, I pray that everything that is said and done now as we open up your word, God, would draw us deeper and closer in our relationship with you, God, and Lord, that we would just celebrate the miracle that is Easter. It's in your name we pray. And everybody said, amen. Amen. You can be seated. Listen, I love that song, and they just sang it so well, Name Above All Names. I want you to think about the lyrics here for just a minute. The cross still stands, and the blood still flows. The work is finished, and hell still knows. The grave is still empty. The stone is still rolled. You're still high and lifted up. You're still seated on a throne. We said still over and over again because that's Easter. That's the resurrection, the empty grave, and that song reminds us that Easter still matters. Because if the grave isn't empty from that first Easter morning, then nothing else matters. And so as we worship today, as we gather today, we celebrate every day because after Jesus went to the cross, he rose again. Last night I read a quote, great line from Bob Goff. He said this, darkness fell, his friends scattered, death thought it had won, but heaven just started counting to three. I love it. The Bible says in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 17, if Christ hasn't been raised from the dead, your faith is futile and you're still in your sins. But in fact, Christ has been risen from the dead. And that's what we celebrate on Easter, right? Jesus is alive. That's a big deal. We celebrate it. We make a big deal about it. Listen, if you see him out there today, you're going to see my kids are in matching clothes today, right? They're not happy about it. Maybe yours are in the same boat, right? Why do we do that stuff? Right? It's because Easter's a big deal, right? It's a special day. We celebrate the resurrection of Jesus because it changes us. It makes us new. The resurrection of Jesus has changed me, who I am, from the inside out. It's changed my family, how we are, how we interact, how we love, how we live. It's changed us. My question for you this morning, it's very simple. Have you too been forever changed by Jesus? Have you come to a point in your life where you have spiritually been made alive by the reality of the resurrection of Jesus? I want to say you can be. Jesus is very clear on life and where it's found. If you've got a Bible, join me in John chapter 14, verse 6. We're going to look at one verse this morning. We've got a lot to say about it. And listen, we've been doing service back after back after back last night and today. And the good news for you, twofold. One, there is no service after this. And two, I looked at the battery pack on this microphone. It says I have 3 hours and 32 minutes left before this thing dies. So that's a good news, bad news based on your lunch plans, right? Jesus is clear. Life is found only in him. A lot of things in this world are complicated. A lot of things in this world are hard to figure out, but not Jesus. He's very clear. John 14, 6. Jesus said, I'm the way, I am the truth, and I am the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. Easter's a big deal. The resurrection of Jesus Christ is a big deal. The empty tomb is a big deal. And I want you to understand this morning, Jesus didn't just rise from the dead. He didn't come back after going to the cross to prove a point, right? He didn't just rise in order to show everyone that he could. He rose from the grave so that you and I could have life that is only found in him. He rose from the grave so that we could step into a relationship with God the Father through Jesus. Look at verse 6 again. He says he is the way, the truth, and the life. No one gets to God, to the Father, unless they have a relationship with Jesus. And so based on John 14, 6, based on the words of Jesus today, we're just going to look at two statements. And the first is this. It's Jesus is alive, right? That's Easter. Jesus is alive, and not only is he alive, we see in the words of Jesus, he's alive to make us alive, right? That's the gospel. That's the Christian faith, and we see that it starts at Easter. He is the way, he is the truth, he is the life. No one gets to the Father, heaven and eternal life, apart from him, and it's because of what he did on Easter. If your Bible's still open, flip to the book of Luke now. Chapter 24, we're going to look in Luke 24 at Luke's account, his telling of the first Easter Sunday morning. Luke 24, verse 1 says this, "But on the first day of the week, at early dawn, they went to the tomb. They took the spices they had prepared, and they found that the stone was rolled away from the tomb. But when they went inside, they did not find the body of the Lord Jesus. And they were perplexed about this. And behold, two men stood by them in dazzling apparel. And as they were frightened, they bowed their faces to the ground, and the men said to them, 'Why do you seek the living among the dead? He, Jesus, is not here, but Jesus has risen.'" And the women that heard that from the angels that first Easter morning, that they ran back, they told the disciples, who of course jump up and they run to the tomb. It says in verse 12, "Peter rose, he runs to the tomb, he stooped and he looked inside, and he saw linen clothes by themselves, and he went home marveling at what happened." Jesus is alive, right? That's good news. That's cause for celebration. We can celebrate, smile, and be excited today. Be like Peter here and marvel at the miracle of the resurrection. You know what it means to marvel? It's not a superhero movie thing, okay? Marvel. Be filled with wonder. Let your mind, let your heart be captivated with this fresh and new sense of amazement. Let's marvel. Let's marvel this morning. Don't let the Easter story be dull because you've heard it before. Don't let the miracle of the resurrection become routine or mundane in your heart or in your life. Like Peter here, marvel. Put yourself with him at the tomb, right? Imagine everything that you've been through. Imagine Good Friday. Imagine your Savior being put on a cross. Imagine him being buried in that tomb. And then imagine showing up there that first Easter Sunday morning and seeing the stone gone and looking inside and seeing the burial clothes folded up, right? Be captivated. Right, marvel at the miracle of the resurrection. It's the greatest miracle that the world has ever known. When you're eating lunch today, let this be the topic of conversation. Right, when you're painting eggs or taking pictures or hanging out with family, marvel and smile. Invite people to marvel with you. Discuss it. Talk about it. Right, let it fill your mind. Right, today is not just another day. Today is this incredible celebration of the reality that Jesus is alive, and that's amazing in itself. But it gets even better. Right, Jesus is alive, and we see in his words in John 14, he is alive so that you and I can also be made alive in him. Jesus is very clear on why he came, why he lived, why he died, and why he rose. Don't make it complicated. John 14, 6, one more time. Jesus said, "I am the way, I am the truth, and I am the life. There is no other way. No one comes to the Father," he says, "except through me." He's alive, and he's alive to make us alive, the only way to life. And let me just tell you that I believe this with all my heart. Right, I believe the words of Jesus exactly as he spoke them. I believe everything that we've seen, everything that we've read, and I believe it for several reasons. And even though I do have 3 hours and probably 25 minutes left on that battery pack, I won't take it all. But I do want to share just a few reasons with you, just very plainly, why I believe the words of Jesus, why I believe in the miracle of Easter. And as I share them, here's my prayer for you. You've been prayed for if you're in here right now. My prayer for you is this. If you know Jesus as Lord and Savior, if you have the life that is only available in him, my prayer for you this morning is that you would marvel again at the miracle of the resurrection, right? That your mind and heart would expand, that it would grow, that it would be captivated, that it would be filled with awe and wonder as you just think about the miracle of the risen Jesus. And if you're in here this morning and you would say, you know what, I'm not sure where I stand before God. If you're in here this morning and you'd say, you know what, I'm not sure about Easter, I'm not sure about Jesus, I don't know that I have the life that he talks about in John 14, I don't know that I believed or that I placed my trust in him, my prayer for you is this, is that you would consider the words of Jesus today. That you would place your faith, your trust, your hope in Jesus, and that you would leave here changed, that you would leave here different than the way you came in. My prayer for you this morning is that you would trust in Jesus as your Savior, right? Dozens have already, right here in this room at the end of our service, they've placed their faith and trust in Jesus. They've come to a place where they believed. And if you have not yet trusted Jesus, I'm praying that that would happen for you as well this morning. Let's dive in. Why do I believe what Jesus said in John 14, that life is only in him? First, just simple historical reasons, right? Peter, what did he do? He looked into the tomb that first Easter. We just read it. He went home marveling at what happened. Not what he dreamed up, not what he imagined, not what he thought he saw. He went home marveling at what happened, right? This is a historical fact that happened. Dr. Thomas Arnold, he's a professor of modern history at Oxford University. He says this, I love this. I know of no one fact in the history of mankind which is proved by better and fuller evidence of every sort to the understanding of a fair inquirer than the great sign which God has given that Christ died and he rose from the dead. When you read everything you can read, when you do the work, when you examine history like this Oxford historian, I'm telling you, you'll find that Easter morning, the resurrection has yet to be discredited in any legitimate way. Lee Strobel, he's a journalist turned author. His goal in life, because of some relationships he had, was to prove that Jesus was a myth. And so with all of the resources in the world at his disposal, he set about to do just that. And not only could he not prove that Jesus was a myth or that the resurrection didn't happen, his studies, right, he compiled into a book. Many of you have read it. It's a bestseller. It's called The Case for Christ. See, in his journey, in his studies, as he examined the evidence, he placed his faith and trust in Jesus. He was forever changed by the resurrection of Jesus. We just read the Easter story from the book of Luke, right? In God's word. Luke was very thorough as a writer. He wrote two books in the Bible, the book of Luke and then again the book of Acts. And I love this. Archaeologists have examined the things that he wrote and the things that he cited because he was incredibly thorough. And out of 32 countries, 54 cities, and 9 first century islands that he wrote about and discussed, the archaeologists haven't found one error, one mistake in all of his writings. They confirm that his writings are history, and that's what this is, right? As we look into it, these are the words of God. He's recorded, right? Salvation history. This isn't a crutch or a tradition or a superstition, right? We can know and read the tomb was empty that first Easter morning. Luke is a credible historical source. When you study this, listen, there's not one person in the Bible or outside the Bible, there's not one believer or person that doesn't believe in Jesus that will debate with you about whether or not the tomb was empty that first Easter morning. Nobody debates that. And that's really rare in today's world, isn't it? People argue about anything. They'll debate about anything. Some people debate for sport, and some of you are smiling because you're those people, right? You're just looking for a debate. We had one in our house the other day about lunch, right? We all agreed on Mexican food. I felt like that was a win to get everybody at least moving in the same direction, but then it came down to where, right? And that can be a touchy subject in Houston because there's so many good places, right? There's two in our home that love gringos, right? That's their thing. They love that green sauce, and they will drink it with a straw at the restaurant, okay? And it's not me and Chelsea, okay? It's the kids. There's one that loves Papacitos, and they love the salsa there. And then there's one that loves Lupe's, right? And the beef fajitas at Lupe's. And I think that we're probably at a place where everybody in this room agrees with me, right? Lupe's is the one. If you're going to lunch today, that's where you're going. Listen, of course we don't agree. Listen, every service so far, y'all can let me off the hook this one. I don't need to have the conversation again. Every service so far, people have caught me in the lobby and argued with me about who makes better fajitas than Lupe's. It's ridiculous, okay? But we'll argue about anything. It just proves the point, which is why it's wild to me that no serious scholar, no matter which side they fall on, nobody debates whether or not the tomb was empty that first Easter morning. And so the conversation isn't, was the tomb empty or not? The conversation is, where did Jesus go? Some people would argue the disciples of Jesus stole the body. It doesn't make sense for a lot of reasons. Two of them are that Pilate put a guard of Roman soldiers around the tomb. They would have had no way in. And then two, every single one of the disciples of Jesus, you know how they died? They died a martyr's death because they refused to stop telling people that Jesus had in fact risen from the dead. Right, no way all 12 of these guys and many other followers of Jesus go to their death over a hoax or something that they had done like that. It just doesn't make sense. Some people would argue that the enemies of Jesus stole his body. Well, the enemies of Jesus were the ones that were telling everybody he didn't in fact rise from the dead. So if they had stole his body, as soon as the disciples begin to preach and teach that Jesus had risen, all they've got to do to shut it down is just show the body of Jesus, and then it goes away. So that doesn't make sense, right? That the tomb was empty, it still is today. And there's a lot of people that testified to that. The Bible says in 1 Corinthians 15, starting in verse 5, that Jesus appeared to Cephas, then to the 12, and then he appeared to more than 500 brothers at one time, most of whom are still alive, though some have fallen asleep. That letter, 1 Corinthians, it was written in the 50s, within 20 or so years of the death and resurrection of Jesus. And if you're unfamiliar with how historians look at these firsthand accounts and the timeline of how close they are to the actual events, they drool over things that are written this close to the actual date. Paul writes that letter and he's saying, listen, if you don't believe me that Jesus rose from the grave, go ask somebody. There's plenty of people that are still alive that saw it. There's plenty of people that were there, that were with Jesus, that walked with him, that talked with him, that ate with him. They were with Jesus in person. He didn't go into hiding. He let people know that he was in fact alive, that he did in fact come back for the grave. It's verifiable by hundreds of eyewitnesses, and that's a big deal. If you're going to court, you want the eyewitnesses on your side, and that's what Paul says. He says hundreds of people saw Jesus. They know beyond the shadow of a doubt is true. All you got to do is ask them. And on this side of history, we know that they believed it because of how they lived. They began to live their lives differently because of the resurrection of Jesus. N.T. Wright, great writer, great author, he makes it clear that the first generation of Christians, right, those first century followers of Jesus, that they answer the question of why they were believers with a very straightforward answer. They said, we are Christians. We believe in Jesus because he was raised from the dead. And we know that they believed it because their daily lives changed dramatically. George Weigel, he's a columnist for the Wall Street Journal. He wrote an article a few years ago called The Easter Effect. And he noted changes in first century culture, first century believers, and the patterns of their lives after the resurrection. Listen to some of the things that he notes about how their lives changed. He writes, there was a new dignity given to women in contrast to the classical culture. He wrote, there was a self-denying health care that Christians provided to those suffering from the plague and other illnesses. Everybody else is running away. The Christians are coming to give aid. He wrote, there was a new focus on family, health, and growth. He wrote, there was a remarkable change in worship from the Sabbath to Sunday, right? Everything shifted, even in the way they worshiped, from the Sabbath to Sunday. Why Sunday? Because Sunday is the day that Jesus rose from the grave. And he wrote this. This is so powerful. He wrote, these first century Christians, they now had this willingness to embrace death as martyrs because they knew that death did not have the final word in the human story. And then he writes this. They begin to live as if they knew the outcome of history itself. Their lives were changed. And our columnist Weigel suggests that it's only through what he calls the Easter effect that these changes actually make sense. The social changes, the lifestyle changes that followed Good Friday occur only if all of these people actually believe in the resurrection of Jesus. And they believed because they saw it. And after they saw it, they told others and they wrote it down for us to see in history. Second, I believe this. Jesus rose for biblical reasons. 1 Corinthians 15:3. Christ died for our sins in accordance with the scriptures, right? The Old Testament part of our Bible. He was buried and he raised on the third day, again, in accordance with the scriptures. Everything that happened to Jesus, his life, or beginning with his birth, everything, his life, his betrayal, his arrest, his death on a cross, his burial in a tomb, and not just a tomb, his burial in a borrowed tomb, all of it was to give us life, just like he said, but all of it was written down before it happened. Right, it's written down in the Old Testament so that as we looked and read and study, we could know beyond the shadow of a doubt that Jesus is the one that God promised, that Jesus is the one that God was sending so that you and I could have life. That's what he said. Luke 24, after he rose from the grave that first Easter, he said, guys, this is what I told you while you were still with me. Everything that was written down in the Old Testament, all of it had to happen. Do you know that conservatively there's 332 prophecies that are fulfilled in the life of Jesus? It's a lot, right? Written hundreds of years before Jesus walked the earth. There's a mathematician by the name of Peter Stoner. He wrote a book called Science Speaks, where he uses probability to rule out any coincidences here. And instead of taking and examining all 332, he just picked eight. Right, eight of these prophecies that Jesus fulfilled and said, what are the chances that any one person could fulfill these? His answer, it's on the screen. It's 1 in 10 to the 17th power. I can't say it. I can't pronounce it. And I said that in the first service, and my sixth grader came and was able to pronounce it right, okay? He's the math guy, not me. All I know is this rules out any coincidences. Right, all of the Bible points to, it pictures, it previews Jesus beginning to end. And as we read it, let me just tell you that he's the one that helps us to understand it, right? That brings me to my next reason. We believe this is true for spiritual reasons. 1 Peter 1, verse 3 says this, blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to his great mercy, he caused us to be born again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. He caused us to be born again. The only way we believe this and step into that relationship with God is as God moves in our life, right? God speaks to our hearts. He gives us clarity. He gives us understanding. He moves, he pulls, he pushes, he draws us to himself. If you believe this already, if you're beginning to believe it this morning, if you're leaning into Jesus, let me just tell you, it's because God is at work in your heart and in your life right here and now. Jesus said in John 6:44, no one can believe, no one can come to me unless the Father that sent me draws him to me. And I believe this. I believe that Jesus is alive and he's alive to give me life because God drew me to him when I was 13 years old. The Holy Spirit worked in my heart when I heard a sermon very similar to this. It's like God opened my eyes and just helped me understand what this was all about. He opened my eyes to my sin and how my sin had separated me from him. He opened my eyes to the words of Jesus that life is found only in Jesus. And that it's only through that life we have in Jesus that I can have a relationship with God, have my sins forgiven, have the hope and promise of heaven and eternal life. It all comes from knowing Jesus. And at the end of the service that night, the pastor led in a prayer, just like I'll do here in a few minutes. And that was the night that I prayed. And I trusted Jesus as my Lord and Savior. And let me just tell you that when I did that, I still had questions. I didn't have all the answers. Right? I still don't. I'm learning. I'm growing. I'm getting to know Jesus more and more every single day. But because God was working in my heart, I knew in that moment I needed Jesus and I couldn't wait. I knew that I needed Jesus and that was my time to trust in him as Savior. And it has been the greatest decision of my life. Listen, I believe for historical and biblical and spiritual reasons, but I want to tell you this morning too that I believe in Jesus for personal reasons. And here's what I mean. I have personally experienced the presence of God over and over in my life. Right? Every moment of my life, from the exciting and joy-filled moments to the most vulnerable, anxious, and hopeless moments, Jesus has always been there. I'm telling you this morning that I have never been alone. As we've lost family members, when health has been in question, when our jobs were uncertain in times of anxiety and pain and despair, listen, through every trial, every single one, Jesus has fulfilled the promise that he's made in his word to never leave, to always be there, to give peace and hope and joy and life in every situation in this world. Listen, I believe that Jesus is alive because I have a personal relationship with him. I want to ask you that question again this morning. Do you have a personal relationship with Jesus? You need one. In John 14, Jesus said that he is the life, that the life is found only in him. A few chapters before that, in John 11, Jesus has a conversation with one of his friends. Now, I want you to hear something about this friend. This friend had been around Jesus for quite a while. This friend had heard the teachings of Jesus. This friend had seen many of the miracles of Jesus. And Jesus has a conversation where he looks into her eyes in this crisis of faith moment, this moment of tragedy. And he speaks to her and he says, I am the resurrection and the life. Again, Jesus tells us he's the life. He says, I am the resurrection and the life. All who believe in me, right, will never die. And he looks at her and he says, do you believe this? So I want you to imagine her for a minute. She is face to face with Jesus. She's having this moment where she's got to decide for herself, do I believe in Jesus or not? Do I believe that life is found only in him or not? And she's got to answer. Right? Nobody can answer for her. A parent can't answer. A friend can't answer. A spouse can't answer. A family member can't answer. She's got to answer the question. Does she believe that life is found in Jesus? Every one of us has to answer that same question. Do we believe that life is found in Jesus? Do we believe that Jesus is our way to a relationship with God, that Jesus is our way to heaven and to eternal life? Let me ask you this morning, have you placed your faith in Jesus? And I just want to tell you in the simplest way possible how you can do that. If you're here today and you're unsure, if you're here today and you know you haven't, if you're here today and you're ready to take that step, if you feel God working in your heart, don't ignore it, right? You can trust Jesus just like this. The first step for all of us is that we've got to come to a place where we admit that we're sinners. That shouldn't be too hard. We all know that we've done something at one time or another that's displeased our Heavenly Father. Romans 3:23 says that all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. Me, you, everybody else. We've got to admit that and understand that our sin separates us from a holy God. Then we've got to come to a place where we believe. We've talked about that this morning. Where we believe that Jesus died for us. Make it personal. Believe today that Jesus died for you. Romans 5:8 says, God shows his love for us, and that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. He didn't say, get it all figured out first. He didn't say, clean yourself up. He didn't say, make all these changes and then come to me. No, while we were still sinners, while we were still separated, God sent his one and only son, Jesus, to pay the price for our sins. We've got to admit we're sinners. We've got to believe that Jesus died for us. And then see, we've got to confess that Jesus is Lord. Romans 10:9 says, if you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord, and you believe in your heart God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. Not you might be, you will be saved. 10:13 says, for everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. If you've never done that, this morning I want to invite you to. Would you bow your heads with me today? If you're here and you know you're at this place where you've got to answer the question for yourself, you've got to answer, do you believe in Jesus? If you're ready to trust in him, if you're ready to step into the life that's available only in him, if you're ready to become a child of God with the promise of heaven and eternal life, I'm going to ask you to pray this prayer with me, similar to the one that I prayed when I became a follower of Jesus. I want to encourage you, if you believe this, repeat this in your head and your heart. You don't need to say this out loud. This is between you and the Lord. Say this in a prayer. Say, Lord Jesus, save me. Say, I know I'm a sinner and that my sin has separated me from a relationship with you. In this prayer, keep praying. Say, I believe that Jesus, your Son, died for my sins. I believe he was buried and he rose on the third day at first Easter. Pray that. Pray and say, I believe that by trusting in Jesus, I now have a relationship with you. A relationship that will last forever. Pray and say, thank you for entering my heart and saving me today. And if you prayed that prayer, everybody's heads still bowed, our eyes are closed. If you prayed that prayer, I'm going to ask you to take a bold step. I want to be able to celebrate with you this morning. I want to know what God's doing in your heart this morning. If you believed in Jesus, in just a minute, I'm going to ask you, like we've done in all of our other services, just to raise your hand and let me know, not to embarrass you, but to celebrate with you. If God's spoken in your heart, if you've taken that bold step today to trust Christ on the count of three, I'm just going to ask you, everybody else's head's bowed, their eyes are closed. Take this stand for Jesus. Don't wait. Don't look around. Right? By faith, right, you've answered the call. By faith, let me celebrate with you. If you trusted Christ, if you just prayed that prayer, would you raise your hand on three? One, two, three. Just slip that hand up. Keep them up for just a minute. Don't put it down. Hold it up. Be bold. Be proud of what God's doing in your heart, what God's doing in your life. And if your hand is up, I'm talking to you right now. Right, I want to encourage you, do not leave here today. Don't leave here today without letting us celebrate with you and giving you a gift on your way out. Dozens of hands in every section of this room. Church family, can we just celebrate what God's doing in here today? Give it up for them. Give it up for the Lord as he's been working. Listen, stay locked in with me for just a minute. This is really, really important. Right, if you trusted in Christ today, we want to help you get off to a good start in your walk with him. We want to put a brand new Bible, a nice Bible in your hands and give you some stuff to read as you go. Listen, you just trusted Christ. The Bible says in 2 Corinthians chapter 5 that you became a new creation, right? The old stuff that was in you is gone, right? You're a new creation in Christ. The Bible says in John 1:12 that anyone that calls on the name of Jesus becomes a child of God. Let me just tell you that if you are one of those that trusted in Jesus today, you are completely new by the grace of God in your life. And listen, the best thing that you can do to grow in that relationship and to foster it is to get in the Word of God, to begin reading your Bible. We want to put that in your hands. This card you got when you came in, you can fold this bottom part off, check that you've trusted in Christ, and give it to one of our balloon towers on the way out to celebrate with you. You give us that, we'll put the Bible in your hands. It's how we know who to give the Bibles to on your way out. They look just like this, right? There's a balloon tower right here. You can come in the worship center and flow this way, or as you leave, there's one out each one of those doors. Just stop at a tower. Hand us the card. Let us celebrate what God is doing in your life. And by the way, everybody got this card as you came in. Let me just point out that registration is open for everything you see here. Vacation Bible school in the summer for your kiddos, camp in the summer for your kiddos. If you've got kids second grade through fifth grade like I do, I was told by our kids minister that there's a $50 discount if you sign them up Easter weekend. So if you want your kiddos to go to camp and save a little money in the process, I encourage you to sign them up this weekend. You can find it all right there. And that QR code on the back of your seat, ton of information about our church. If you're new, you can scan that. Or if this is your first Sunday, when you leave, out front, there's a tent set up. That tent's for you, right? We want to put a gift in your hand to thank you for being with us. And it's got some information about our church family as well. If you'll stand with me now, I'm going to pray and we'll be dismissed. Again, most important thing, right? Most important thing, if you trusted Christ today, let us give you that Bible on your way out. Stop at one of these towers. Let us celebrate. We'll give you the Bible. And then, not the next most important thing, but it's sort of important. It's down the list a little bit. We've got that egg hunt out back for your kiddos. If you've got kids here that want to participate, fifth grade and under, I was told I was too old, so fifth grade and under, it's out there. Get your kiddos. That'll be about 10 minutes after the service dismisses. Stop at the balloon tower, pick up your Bible if you trusted Christ, and then meet us out back. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we love you. We trust you. We thank you for Jesus. God, I pray that every one of us, whether we trusted Christ 5 minutes ago, or if we've been walking with you for 50 years, God, I pray that we would leave here marveling at the miracle of the resurrection. God, like Peter, that first Easter morning, God, that we leave here, that our minds would be filled with wonder and amazement and celebration at who you are and what you've done, because you love us. It's in your name we pray. And everybody said, amen. Amen. Have a great day.